to speak from His Word. I want to start reading from the Word of God. It's from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'll read it. 1 Corinthians 1 Corinthians 15. It says like this. Paul is writing to the church of Corinth. Let me now remind you, dear brothers and sisters, for the good news I preached to you before, you welcomed it then, and you still stand firm in it. It is this good news that saves you if you continue to believe the message I told you, unless, of course, you believe something that was never true in the first place. I passed on to you what was most important and what had also been passed on to me. Christ died for our sins, just as the scripture said. He was buried and he was risen from the dead on the third day, just as the scripture said. He was seen by Peter and then the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he was seen by James and later by all the apostles. Last of all, as though I had been born at the wrong time, I also saw him. For I am the least of all apostles. In fact, I am not even worthy to be called an apostle after the way I persecuted the church. But whatever I am now, it is all because of God poured his special favor on me. Now I'm going to read from 12. But tell me this, since we preach that Christ rose from dead, why are some of you saying there will no resurrection for the dead? For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been risen either. And if Christ has not been risen, then all our preaching is useless, and your faith is useless, and we apostles would all be lying about God, for we have said that God raised Christ from the grave. But that can't be true if there is no resurrection from the dead. And if there is no resurrection from the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless, and you are still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. Towards the last couple of more words, it's from 51. It says like this, but let me reveal to you that wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will all be transformed. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when that last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever. Then we who live in will also be transformed. Now, again, going down, it starts from verse 54. Then our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die. The scriptures will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in the death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. If Jesus Christ is not risen, then I would say that we are wasting our time here. There's no need to come in every Sunday and then worship like this, and then this building and everything will be a waste of money. All the tithe and offerings that you're putting, just a waste. You can spend that in something else, right? But if Jesus Christ is risen from death, then everything that he said must be true. Okay? Now, I want to go back to the initial portion of the scripture that I read. It is in verses 3. The Christ died for our sin, just as the scripture said. And he was buried, and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as scripture said. Can you go to the next slide, please? The three things that it says, that Paul says about him. Christ died, he was buried, he was resurrected. So what does this mean to us? So Christ died. Many people think that Jesus just came out of the cross without happening all these things. If a man dies here, what we will do? If our dear one dies in this world, we will be like very sad, upset. We will be mourning for them, remembering them, all the things that they did, and then we will wrap them in the burial cloths, put them into the coffin, and then we will pray for the family, and then we will actually bury them in the tomb, and then that's it, right? That's all we can do. But Paul says that Christ died, he was buried, just like everybody did, and he is risen from the dead, and he is alive forevermore.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. And the resurrection is the heart of our faith, not the cross. A cross without a resurrection means nothing to us. That doesn't do any good. And many people focus on the cross now. No, the resurrection must be the heart of our faith. Amen. Hallelujah. And then what do you mean by resurrection, actually? It's just like that person coming back to life. Is that what it is? Lazarus did the same thing. Right? The son of the widow had named, she did the same thing too. They come back from life. One time, Elisha did the same thing in the Old Testament. So, if you can go to the next slide, please. So what do you mean by resurrection? I just want to make that distinction here. So there are three things that we need to look into. There's something called a resuscitation, there's something called reincarnation, and there's something called a resurrection. So what do you mean by resuscitation? That is exactly what happened to Lazarus and everybody who been raised from dead, apart from Jesus. Because they been died, and somebody prayed for them. Even Lazarus was in the tomb for 4 days. He was wrapped in the burial clothes. And when Jesus said that, Lazarus, come back, he came back into his old body. The same old body, the same man, but he died again, right? He died again. Everybody who was resuscitated, they died again. Only thing that there is, that they postponed the death for some more time. And that is not resurrection. Now what is resuscitation? That is another version of it. It says that you will come back to life as a new person. Many religions believe in the same. You will come back as a new person. You will not be having any memory or any consciousness of who you were earlier. And in some religion, you believe that sometimes you will come back as an animal, like a frog or a bird. You know. So that is reincarnation. So if they go to a lot of troubles in their life, they will say that in the last life I might have done something really wrong, that's why I'm suffering. That is not resurrection. What does resurrection mean? Jesus came back to this life and God gave him a new body which will not die anymore. And he is alive forevermore. And that is the heart of our faith. The resurrection is the heart of our faith. Amen. Hallelujah. And that's why we are here to worship a risen leader, because no other religion in this world is started by a man who is raised from death. No other religion. And we should be proud that we are a Christian. If you are not feeling that proudness, then you don't understand Christ. That is what Jesus did for us. No other religion in this world did by a person like that. Only Jesus raised from dead, and that's why we follow him. Amen. Hallelujah. And he came back in a new body. and he is alive. That is the heart of our faith. Amen. And the resurrection is the center of our faith. Now, without resurrection, Christianity means nothing. In all the movies that been filmed, they go all the way till the cross, the death of Jesus, but nobody talks about what happened after that. And that's why many of our youngsters don't know what happened after that. And we have our Bible study last year, what happened after death. God raised him through his spirit, gave him a new body. And that's what a pastor said like this. The cult of this world said that he is too bad to live. But God said he is too good to rot in the grave. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Now when we start saying this to other people, they will ask, what is the proof that God, that Jesus is alive now? What is the proof that you can offer? Right? If somebody says that Neil Armstrong landed in moon in whatever year, said, yeah, I believe it. But if you say that Jesus raised from death, no, how can it be? Were you there with Neil Armstrong when he was landing on the moon? No, but I believe it. But if you say that Jesus raised from death, all kind of opposition will start coming up. Because if Jesus raised from death, then you cannot live like you were living before. Because whatever that he said must be true. Okay, go to the next slide. Now, what are the proof that we can offer the world that Jesus is alive? What are the proof that we got? How can you say that Jesus is alive? Many times we have to face that question, right? There are two things that any court or any jury will be looking to prove that a particular event happened in this, a particular event has occurred, right? Jury was not present at the time of the crime that was happening, but they will be looking for two kind of evidences. What is that? One is the eyewitness, okay? And second is the circumstantial evidences, right? Now, Bible offers both very strongly. Now, Paul says that in the same chapter, there in the same verse number 5, it says that he was seen by Peter and then by the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 followers at one time, most of whom are still alive. Some of them are dead. Now, these people are living among you. Those are your eyewitness. Right? And then Paul says that in the gospel, apostles testify that. Now when we present that testimony to them, that eyewitness, people will start objecting, says that, no, they were not exact same accounts. Somebody says it is one angel, somebody says it's two angels. But if you look at a genuine eyewitness, they always differ to a little bit because they were independent eyewitnesses. Think of it. If three photographers are taking my photographs, one from here, one from here, one from here, all the photographs will look alike. They differ. But it's the same event that happened. And if somebody says that there is only one angel, yes, that is true. He saw only one angel at that time. If somebody says that they saw two, yeah, because they were independent eyewitness witnessing the resurrection of Jesus. And we have a list of eyewitnesses that have been given in the Bible. Everybody saw Jesus. And more than 500 followers saw him at once. And when Paul was preaching at that time, they were still alive. Right? Now the circumstantial evidences, what do I mean by that? Let's say the person hit and run somebody and then he didn't stop. He just went away. Now when police is investigating this case, what happened? Then first they will be looking at whether this person took this car to a body shop next day to fix that car. That's a good piece of circumstantial evidence, right? Or like if somebody shoots somebody or somebody killed one, and if that weapon had been purchased by that person a couple of days back, that is a good piece of circumstantial evidence, right? Now, that is what Paul is trying to tell. So that kind of circumstantial evidence, we have many in the Bible, right? Now, the change in the disciples' behavior, that is a very good piece of circumstantial evidence. You think about Peter. When Jesus was caught, Jesus has been caught to crucify. One person asked, "Are you with that Jesus?" What did Peter say? "No, I am not with Jesus. I don't know him." Then another girl asked him, "Hey, I think you were that guy with him. He was bragging that I'm not him." But once after he saw the resurrected Jesus, see the change in them. It's like, I'm not afraid of anything more because I know who am I believing in. Amen. Hallelujah. Who am I? I don't know who am I believing in. Earlier I was not sure about that. But now I saw him, the risen Christ. And no matter what happened to my body, I still stand for it. That's a good piece of circumstantial evidence. Everybody. When they were trying to crucify Peter, said that, "Okay, do me upside down. I'm ready to do it." Do you do that for somebody who is doing a fraud? No. Because you need to have enough evidence that they saw him. Right? So, the one of the things that promo is not today, but I need to make that announcement, because last committee meeting we were deciding that we're going to change our Sunday worship service to Monday. And since it's a working day, we will be doing it at 5 o'clock in the morning and then after 9. So that pastor will be explaining that to you all. What? What is this? Exactly what everybody was asking. Why Jews changed from worshiping on a Saturday to Sunday? Why Jews changed their worship from Saturday to Sunday? You go and convince any Jew to do that. I was like, people were like, "What is going on here?" Right? Jews changed their day of worship from Saturday to Sunday. And what does that mean? Jesus raised on the first day of the week, it was Sunday. And they changed it. If you try to make a tradition here, I was seeing in many people's eyes, what is going to happen now? You cannot break that tradition. But that's a good piece of circumstantial evidence, right? Now, so third piece that I want to give in here is that if somebody is coming into Christ, look at the change that is happening to them. The prisoner, the people who stay in the prison, who had a bad life, who's drinking and smoking and doing all, they stop all these things because they know that they are the temple of God. They don't want to, you know, spoil that temple of God anymore. And these are the evidences that tells that Jesus Christ is still alive. Amen. Right? So we have two pieces of evidences: the eyewitnesses, circumstantial evidences. Everything is there in the Bible, but people don't want to believe because they don't want to believe. Because if they start believing the circumstantial evidences, then they have to change the way they are living now. Okay, now, why God raised Jesus from death? Next slide, please. Two things. God was basically reversing the verdict of the human court. As I said, court said that he is too bad to live. He said he is too good to die. And that's what God did. Now, what is that? Human sin must be paid for. Jesus could have just walked out of the cross just like that. Right? If he could do the things that he did earlier, he could have just walked out of that tomb, that cross. Many people were mocking him. "Hey, if you are the Son of God, just come out." And Jesus could have done that. Just as easy as like I'm speaking to you. But Jesus never did. And that was a sacrifice for our sin, so that we can put our sinful life into him and take the righteous life from him. Amen. Hallelujah. And that sacrifice was fully, completely accepted by God. There is no more sacrifice needed. All we need to do is that. Accept Christ, repent our sin, and live our life for him. Amen. Hallelujah. So that's what it is. And if Jesus said who he is, and if he is risen from death, and then everything that he said must be true. And he said he's going to come back again. He's going to judge this world. So everybody who's standing here must stand before him. Now, when we say that, some people think that only the good people will rise again. No, everybody who died will rise again, right? It's in Acts 24, chapter 15, Acts 24, verse 15. Can somebody read that? Acts 24, 15.
And have hope toward God, which they themselves also allow, that there shall be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and the unjust.
Both for the just and the unjust. Everybody will rise again. Now what happened? Many people think that if they are too fed up with their life, suicide is the last answer to their problems. But the shock is that the moment you are died, in a very couple of moments, you will realize that you are not fully dead. But what death means, the Bible makes it clear that a death means you are not active in this world. You cannot communicate with people, but you will be conscious. The parable of the rich man and the Lazarus, Jesus says that you will be conscious. So suicide is not an answer to your problem, right? The dead and the righteous and the unrighteous, the just and unjust, will rise again. But the problem is where you will spend your eternity. That is the biggest problem. To be with Christ, ruling in this world as governors, or in the darkness of the eternal hell. That is what we need to look into. Amen. And to the next slide, please. Now, the last thing that I want to mention here is that what happened in resurrection? What the law could not do. What the law could not do, God did by sending his son. Amen. That's what Romans 8, chapter 3 and chapter 8, verses 3 and 4 says that. What the law could not do. A law cannot make a bad person a good person. A law can punish a person, bad person. But Christ can make a bad person to be a good person. Amen. All we need to do is go back to Jesus. Put our sinful life in him. Repentance. And then take his righteous life and put on to it. Hold on to his promises. That is what we need to do. And this is the time that we're going to sing the last song that we sung here. I'm going to invite all the youths to come back. One more song. The last song that we did. It's called Agnes Dei. And we know that our God rose from dead. And many people were not able to worship the last time. But this is time that we all going to stand up. And then we all going to worship with that song. It is called, the youth is going to sing that song.
You know what Ben was mentioning about changing the days to Monday? I thought that he was going to end April Fool's. But he didn't. But you know, there's a lot of things that are happening today that we're celebrating. Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Amen? That's not April Fool's. We're Christians bought by the blood of the Lamb. That's not an April Fool's joke. Amen? We are Christians here ready to worship God. That's not an April Fool's joke. Amen? We're all believing in Christ today morning. That's not an April Fool's joke. Amen? We're all here to give him our best. That's not an April Fool's joke, is it? Amen? We're all here to worship him with our all, with everything that we've got. That's not an April Fool's joke, amen. As we build up and ready to worship him this morning, that's not going to be an April Fool's joke. We're going to give him our best. We're going to give him our best. Hallelujah. We're Pentecostal Christians, believers in the Lord Almighty. Believers in Jesus Christ. Believers that He is the only one. He is the Almighty. He is our Master. He is our Lord and Lord. He is our God. He is our Master, our Savior. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus.
For the Lord God Almighty.
worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Father God, we come before your presence right now to be able to glorify your name. We glorify your name together. Hallelujah. We honor you, Jesus. We lift you up on high, oh God. We celebrate your resurrection Sunday this morning. We worship you. We praise you. We realize, as we heard, not only this morning, not only on Easter Sunday, every day of the life that you've given us, every moment that you give us, every time, every second that you allow us to breathe on this earth, we allow you to be able, that you allow us to be able to live on this earth. We praise you. We glorify you. We praise your name. We lift your name up on high, and we realize that you have given us another chance, another opportunity, another chance to be able to worship you. Our whole purpose in life, to be able to worship you and glorify your name. We thank you for the message. We thank you for the songs. We thank you for the opportunity to come before your holy presence. We thank you for allowing us to be able to kneel before you, oh Master, our Savior, our resurrected King, who's given us another opportunity, who's given us another chance to be able to live holy unto you, oh God. Thank you for hearing our prayers. We ask all these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.